So after covering the TFCC injuries in the previous video, in this video we will study about the various ulnar sided procedures that are indicated. So we have the few indications of these procedures. So first is a persistent pain of the DRUJ. Second is the rotational contracture. Patient is not able to perform the rotational movement at the wrist joint. Third is the instability of the distal radial ulnar joint. And fourth, it is also done in adjoint to the distal and radius osteotomy. So after doing the distal and radius osteotomy, in cases of the malunion of the distal and radius, we check if the on table the rotation is possible. So if the rotation is not possible, we can go for the ulnar sided procedures on the table itself. So we have the various five procedures. We will discuss it one by one, various indications. So first is the Bowers procedure. So this Bower procedure is the hemi resection interposition arthroplasty. So as the name indicates, it is the hemi resection. So we cut the ulna half. So it is a hemi resection of the ulna. So what all it is preserved? We have the preservation of the ulna styloid. We have preservation of the a part of the TFCC. And ulnar column cortex is preserved. So this is the Bower procedure. So it is the hemi resection. So what is resected? The substantial part of the ulnar head is resected. And what is preserved? Ulnar styloid is preserved, part of TFCC, and ulnar column cortex is preserved. Then it is an interposition arthroplasty. So what is interposed in this area? It is the capsule, the wrist capsule, a flap of the wrist capsule. It is interposed in this area. So it is only done in cases where it is a joint instability, or it is a painful, or it is a rotational contracture, but the ulnar positive variance should not be there. So cases where there is a positive ulnar variance, where the distal ulnar joint is distal to the sigmoid notch, which is known as the positive ulnar variance. So cases where there is a positive ulnar variance, this procedure cannot be done because it doesn't address that part of the problem. So this is the Bower procedure. So it is a hemi resection interposition arthroplasty, where a partial resection of the articular surface is cut and interposition of the capsular flap is done. So it is preferred in case of the DRUJ arthrosis with mild degree of the ulnar variance or no ulnar variance. So then studying about the second procedure, which is more commonly done, it is the Schwab-Kapandji procedure. So in this procedure, a segment of ulna is excised at the level of the ulnar neck. So as indicated here, so a segment of ulna at the level of the ulnar neck is excised, and the distal part of the ulna, it is fixed. Arthrodesis is done at the level of the distal radial ulnar joint with the help of a screw. So this is the Schwab-Kapandji procedure. So what we are doing the arthrodesis of the distal radial ulnar joint, and plus we are creating the pseudo arthrosis of the distal ulna. This here a pseudoarthrosis is created and a arthrodesis is created at the distal radial ulnar joint. So this is more commonly done in the young and active patients. The only problem that patient can present with is the impingement of this proximal part of the ulna. So painful instability of the proximal ulnar stump can be one of the problem. So this was the Schwab-Kapandji procedure. So here we can see here that a distal part of the ulna at the level of the ulnar neck, it is excised, and arthrodesis is done at the distal radial ulnar joint. So what are indication of this procedure? So as we have discussed that this is done in young patients. So the indication is that, first indication is that if there is instability of the distal radial ulnar joint, if there is a persistent pain at the distal radial joint, and plus it can also be done in cases where there is a positive ulnar variance. In those cases, we have to slide the distal and this part of the ulna downwards and then fuse it with the radius. So this was about the swab Kuppanji procedure. Now another procedure which is commonly done is the Dyche procedure. So this procedure, the distal end radius, distal end of the ulna is excised completely. Now how to define this level of the ulna, the level of excision of ulna? So this level of excision is defined from the proximal level of the sigmoid notch. So the ulna is excised at the level of the proximal level of the sigmoid notch. This is done only in elderly patient. The level is the proximal end of sigmoid notch and the distal end of the ulna is excised. So there are various complications associated with this procedure. So we are talking about the Dyche procedure, in which the distal articular surface of ulna is removed. It is useful in elderly and those patients with limited activity. Now we know that there is a FCU and the ECU slings that are associated with distal ulna. So these slings have been fashioned to attach to the distal ulna to address the ulna stability. So these slings can be attached to the remaining part of the ulna so that the radio ulnar impingement doesn't occur. So we have the very complication associated with this. We first is the ulnar impingement syndrome. So this distal end ulna, it impinges upon to the radius causing pain. So for that, these slings are attached to this remaining part of the ulna to address the ulna instability. Plus there is loss of the grip strength and there can be a ulna translation of the carpus. The carpal bones can translate ulnarly because of loss of bone in this region. Then talking about another procedure, we have the ulnar shortening procedure. So this procedure is indicated where there is a positive ulnar variance. So the cases where there is a positive ulnar variance. So this procedure is also done in association with the radio distal and radius osteotomy. So firstly, if there is a malunion of the distal and radius, we can go for the distal and radius osteotomy. And the shortening of the distal and radius can be addressed from the osteotomy itself. About 7 mm of the height can be gained from the distal and radius osteotomy. But even after the osteotomy, there is a positive ulnar variance, we can go for the ulnar shortening procedure, where transverse cuts are made at the level of the diaphysis and a compression plate is applied. So this is the ulnar shortening procedure. And lastly, we have the Salvage procedure, which is the ulnar head replacement. So this is salvage procedure where there is a radio ulnar impingement, as we have discussed. So this is only done after the failure of the swab Kuppanji or the Bowers procedure. So these are the various procedures. So briefly summarizing them all. So we have the three important procedures. We have the hemiresection of the distal ulna and a interposition arthroplasty. We have the distal radio ulnar joint arthrodesis, which is the swab Kuppanji procedure. We have the Dyche procedure done in elderly, where entire distal end radius is removed. Sometimes the radial stoloid can be preserved. And then we can have the ulnar shortening, which can be done along with the distal end radius osteotomy. If even after distal end radius osteotomy, length is not gained and still there is positive variance of the ulna. Now, ulnar shortening procedures. Now, if there is associated degenerative changes at the radiocarpal joint or the ulnocarpal joint, we can combine it with the Bowers procedure also. So, after ulnar shortening, we can go for the hemiresection arthroplasty in the same patient itself if we are having degenerative changes at the ulnocarpal joint. And lastly, in case of the failure of Bowers or the swab Kuppanji procedure, we can go for the ulnar head replacement. So that was about the various ulnar sided procedures. Thank you.